they went up to up on the top of Mount Hermon with Jesus, and Jesus was transfigured. And we read that scripture. Jesus was radically changed. His appearance was changed from an earthly man to a heavenly man. His appearance. You know, most of our Jesus experiences are much less dramatic. And it's normally when we give our life to Christ or when we're baptized. You know, but we can have other Jesus experiences. I don't want us to think about limited to baptism or salvation in baptism. There's other Jesus experiences. You know, in the Methodist Church, once a month, we have an experience with Jesus when we partake of the body and blood of Christ, communion. That is a Jesus experience. Miracles. How many of you have had a miracle happen in your life? That's a Jesus experience. That's a Jesus experience. Answered prayers. You know, sometimes we pray for miracles, and sometimes they just happen. How many of you had a prayers answered? Okay, again, that's a Jesus experience. That's a Jesus experience. You know, we should pray for a Jesus experience every day. Now, I'm as guilty as some of y'all probably are. I'm not going to say all of you, but at least some of y'all are. We should wake up, Lord. Let us experience you today. Lord, be in our midst. Be in our life. Show us that joy that little girl and her dad sang off of. Let us experience you in some shape, form, or fashion. Help me get through today. Walk with me and talk with me and be by my side. Amen. You know, the Jesus experience comes with benefits. You know, I thought, you know, sometimes I know down the road what I'm going to preach on next, and I said, well, how should I go after this message? I said, well, there's benefits. There's benefits. Of course, that's how you see it. I call it the Jesus experience benefits. Sort of like job benefits. Bonuses. You know, I guess a salary is not a benefit. I guess it is because when you expect a salary when you go to work and do a job. So I don't necessarily call that a benefit. Benefits are some sort of extra. Maybe. You know, bonuses. I remember when Cisco bought Scientific Atlanta and I was working there. And my goodness, they give bonuses. And it was like, are you kidding me? You know, I think it's only one time I got that bonus before I, you know, took the retirement. It's like, wow, you know, I can live with that. That's a benefit. You know, it benefited me financially. You know, insurance, vacation, sick leave, retirement—all those are benefits we look at when we consider a job or whether we stay in a job. Everyone should know the Jesus experience benefits. It can be life-changing. It can be life-changing. You know, they're in the handbook. All the benefits are in the handbook. All in there. Have you read them? Hope you have, and I appreciate. I hope my leaders and worship leaders read the lesson. And I hope you do too. And I make it easy for you. I give you a link to click on if you're on. If I don't have your email and you want me to, you know, get my Friday email, what I'm going to preach on, just give me your email address. Or mine is at the top of this email me. It's at the top of the book. Give you a link. You ain't got to get out your Bible. Maybe I'll make it too easy. You know, said, well, it'd be nice to do it when we all get to heaven. You know, I thought about that when I put it together, and the Spirit's dead. Praise be to God. But let's look at a few of these benefits. I'm going to read a little bit more scripture than I normally read. So let's look at Philippians chapter 3, verses 20 and 21. For our citizenship is in heaven, from which also we eagerly wait for a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform the body of our humble state into the conformity with the body of His glory by the exertion of the power He has, even to subject all things to Himself. Benefit number one. Paul tells us here in heaven, in Philippians, access to heaven. Access to heaven. You know, do you want to go to heaven? Do you? You know, sometimes I think, and I'm not necessarily saying y'all, you know, per se, but sometimes you hear stuff and see stuff, and I just wonder about people. Do the people really want to go to heaven? Part of it is because, and I said this before, is because we have it made in our society. You know, I'm talking, you know, the country always, you know, there's always problems, political problems, economic problems. There's different problems, you know, and people, you know, all that stuff. But basically, we have it made. You know, how far do you have to go to get to Publix? Not very far. Or a Kroger, or an Ingles, or a Piggly Wiggly, or an Aldi. The point is, I don't know, sometimes I believe we have as close to heaven as you can get on this earth, in some ways. In some ways, I know we have troubles in our life and problems and all that. I'm not saying that it's going to be without problems. Sometimes I wonder if people really want to go to heaven. If they want to go to heaven and hear the praises of the angels, you know, and that's just maybe me as a pastor observing and talking to people and all this kind of stuff. But you know, praise be to God, would you have access to heaven? And we don't go like this. In Jesus, we have that benefit of being a citizen of heaven due to our sins being forgiven. You know, let me say this. You go ask, and I watch it frequently, Water's World on Fox, and Kim is what people go. I have heard this a long time. If you were to go out on the street and say, what does it take to get to heaven? Well, I think I'm just good enough. I think I'm good enough. If I'm good enough, I can get to heaven. No, that ain't how it works. That's what the world thinks out there. You don't get to heaven by being good enough. You dead and draw my last breath, but that ain't going to get me to heaven. It's going to get me to heaven because my sins have been forgiven because of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Let's look at Colossians chapter 1, verses 13 and 14. For he delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. In Christ, our sins are forgiven. Past, present, and yes, even future. We are reconciled to God. We are redeemed. Believers in Christ are rescued from eternal damnation. We become citizens of the kingdom of God. Kingdom of heaven, kingdom of God, it's pretty much interchangeable in the New Testament. But we become citizens of heaven because our sins have been forgiven. You know, the first sermon ever given to the church, you find it to pretty much takes us to Acts chapter 2. Peter's preaching, Acts 2:38. And Peter said to them, repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of sins. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. You know, Peter says the same thing that we read in Colossians, that Paul wrote in Colossians. Actually, Peter said it earlier when Paul wrote it. He says the same thing. Repent. Be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of sin. And then he adds another benefit. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. In Christ, we have the benefit of the Holy Spirit dwelling in us. Now, I preached on this, you know, Pentecost back in May, and I preached on the Spirit experience. And by the way, you can go to YouTube and find all these sermons on YouTube, on our YouTube channel. If you want to, there's probably about 150 on there. But anyway, the Spirit experience. I went into that and went in depth. But we get the Holy Spirit. My discussion with Wyatt, you know, I call it picking on people, but I don't pick on these. But when Wyatt told me, he said, Dick, you know, just sort of, when I was contemplating what all this means and the meaning of life and belief in God and faith, you know, all this kind of stuff, something sort of just clicked with me. Sort of what I remember him saying, when it clicked with you, he said, yeah, Jesus, come into my heart. The Spirit of God began to dwell in me. And every other person in here that has given their life to Christ, the Spirit of God dwells in us to lead us, to guide us in our walk through life that becomes difficult at times. I don't do it enough. Lord help me. Lord lead me. Lord guide me. I'm figuring it out. I was an engineer. I figure stuff out. I know how to get stuff figured out. I'm a man. I'm more of a man. Oh, I can get this stuff figured out. You know, temptation when we sin. I'm going to first cross that out, back, and out. I think that's, I'm going to read this brief. John's first epistle, chapter 2. What John was talking about, he was talking, he begins, my little children. Now, that includes us. We are children of God. But he says, my little children, I'm writing you these things for you that you may not sin. And then he goes, and if anyone sins, you know, did you catch that? I'm writing this for you that you may not sin. But if you do sin, you know, I'm like, okay, whew. I like that. Yeah, I shouldn't sin. But I do. Not as often as I used to. But when I do, it says, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he himself is a propitiation for our sins. Not for ours only, but also for those of the whole world. Again, John's saying, I hope you don't sin. But if you do, you can be forgiven because God sees Christ in you. You know, there's two words in that, those two verses of Scripture. Advocate, which is easier for us to understand, or is for me. And propitiation. I'll try to explain that if I can. I don't know if it's even worth going there, but I'll give it a shot. But first and foremost, you know, I hope you don't sin. But if you do, you can be forgiven because God sees Christ in you. He don't see old sinful Wayne. He sees Christ in me. He sees the sacrifice of Christ. He sees the resurrection of Christ. He sees the blood of Christ. He sees the righteousness of Christ in me. And that is the propitiation. That pleases God. That appeases God. That's what essentially that word, that satisfies God. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Get amen on that. I struggled, went back and forth. That's, oh, I, you know. It's one of those, well, I forgot what the Greek is. We're not going to get into all that. But just to view what the benefits are. Membership in the kingdom of God. Future access to heaven. Going to heaven. But I saw my name showed me in a dream my name written in the Lamb's Book of Life. I know I'm going to heaven when I die. Forgiveness of sins. The Holy Spirit dwelling in us. A heavenly advocate. What's an advocate? An advocate's like a lawyer. It's like a lawyer. And it's essentially what it is. In some way, but not as much legal as a lawyer. Casa, that's the key word, is advocate. On behalf of someone. That's really the key word there. There's some other benefits. Christian camaraderie. I think that's okay. There are people that I know that have met in my Christian walk, in my time, going to different churches, that I could call on in a heartbeat. I might not have seen them for 20 years. And they would be there if I needed them. I haven't seen Renee in 20 years, probably, but they're about. I want you. Then we had a need. I said, I'll be glad to help. Praise be to God for that. But that's Christian camaraderie. Helping others. The satisfaction of helping others. I receive satisfaction. There's nothing wrong with it. It's satisfaction when I see the little kids at Bible school and here on Wednesday night and them having fun and having to hear the Bible lesson and doing this and doing that. Connie, I know you do because I see it on your face. And sometimes she's tired. But I could see that satisfaction of job with them, especially when we see people baptized and come to the Lord. It's crazy not to take advantage of these benefits. Y'all like my dude's voice? That's my sarcastic voice. My sarcasm voice, I guess. It doesn't lead necessarily to a perfect, trouble-free life. My goodness, we know that all too well. But the walk is easier. Lord, thank you for that. It makes it just a little bit easier. And I have my Christian friends I can call on for help. They will pray with me. That's what it's all about. Or that's a lot of it. It goes beyond baptism. It goes beyond giving your life to Christ. That's what John Wesley talked about. Moving on to perfection.